thank you very much for these nice words, and everything is true. thank you for being there. This is a great opportunity for me to present the core ideas of the mentioned book, which we published in some months, unfortunately in German, but I hope then soon some pieces of the book I will be able to publish in English too. So I have only myself there without movie, and an old man in an old building in an old way of giving paper. So I have prepared a paper, I will read it, and I hope it is no longer than so 40 minutes. So sleep well, and then after then give your remarks and questions and critics, please. So I gave the title of my presentation, Wounded, Collective Identity. And what I try to do there only to make more or less understandable what I mean by wounds and by collective identity, especially in the very beautiful, for me at least, and colorful geographical and geocultural area of Europe, the so-called Central and Eastern European area. I have a motto from Byron. Truth is always strange, stranger than fiction. And it is true, I hope, for my topic too. Because I am from Central Europe, I should start with a joke. What is the difference between fish in an aquarium and fish soup? Was asked by Eden Michnik, essayist and former Solidarność activist in 1980s. And he answered, we know very well how to make fish soup from an aquarium, but we don't know how to make an aquarium out of fish soup. 30 years ago, 1988, a book was published in Bremen, Germany, with the title Mitteleuropa, Traum oder Trauma? Central Europe, a Dream or Nightmare? What it explored and discussed is an issue of permanent relevance, the identity of the region called Central Europe, or in a broader perspective, Central and Eastern Europe. In the same year, 1988, I got my first passport valid for Western Europe too, and was able to accept the invitation of the University of Vienna to write my doctoral thesis dissertation in practical theology. In the very turbulent time during my 2 years research period, the question arose regarding what is an appropriate model for understanding the multi-phase transformation processes in the region. The appropriate one. I should confess that I didn't find it in my doctoral thesis, so it is perhaps relaxed for you to. I didn't find it. And not during my habilitation in 1996, not in the second doctoral thesis 2011, and not in my thesis at the Hungarian Academy of Science in 2014, either. But exactly after finishing my work at the Academy, I visited the Srebrenica Memorial Center in Bosnia and Herzegovina, And at that place, I found the core element of an autopoiesis for the region. Woundedness. The word, or the term autopoiesis, is very important for me. I love the word. Not only because it is taken from Luhmann, you know, heteropoiesis, but because the part of the word autopoiesis, the poiesis is there. And many times I think it is perhaps more important to read lyrics and novels from the region to understand the soul of the region, because these very sensibilized people, the writers, perhaps understand more deeper the collective identity of the region as sociologists or as other social scientists. In recent years, I elaborated on this framework to be published, as mentioned already, in this year by Herder Publishing House in Germany. And I am truly honored to have been invited to present my framework here at this prestigious university named after the region of Central Europe. And I kindly invite you to taste with me the fish soup, the collective identity of our region. So now to the theory. Get sleep well. The core element of the theory is the geopolitical or geocultural position of the entire region, which I try to call in-betweenness. The prominent Hungarian intellectual István Bibó published in the interwar period several studies on the self-understanding of the region of Central and Eastern Europe. One of them, written in 1946, bears the title The Misery of the Small States of Eastern Europe. Bibó characterized the region, among other things, through the deformation of political culture, the rise of an anti-democratic brand of nationalism, bitter territorial disputes, language wars, etc. Although, by speaking about Central and Eastern Europe, Bibó analyzed mainly the countries of Poland, Czechoslovakia at that time, and Hungary, but his arguments were valid for the entire region from the Baltic states through Central Europe to the Balkans. Jenő Szűcs, a Hungarian medievalist historian, published a study in 1983 entitled as Three Historical Regions of Europe. Szűcs continued with Bibó's idea, but concentrated more on the relations of production, the distribution of power, and the production processes in the towns and villages of the region in medieval times. Szűcs' main argument is, first, that Central and Eastern Europe has an in-between position between the two hegemonies of East and West. And the second, that there is a kind of developmental, perhaps hierarchical sequence between the three historical regions of Europe. The same argument was later elaborated on and vindicated by many scholars, among them Attila Melek, by using the technical term civilizational slump. It is recently, in this year, in the collected volume edited by Moskalevitz and Przybylski. Referring to both Bibó and Szűcs, as well as his writer friends from the region, such as Václav Havel and Adam Michnik and others, sociologist and novelist György Konrád called the region as a paradox center. paradox here means that the region belongs partly to East and partly to West. And at the same time, partly it does not even belong. During the centuries, it was saturated with the culture of both, as East and West, but has never been an inherent part of the East or of the West. In line with Conrad, we can quote Philip Longworth too, as he stated concerning Central and Eastern Europe, I quote, "It is not the third world, but it is certainly not the Western world either." This geopolitical and geocultural in-between position of the region has a decisive impact on the identity of the entire region, despite the enormous differences among the societies of the region. To remind us only, because you are more historians and you should know everything that I will now list, to remind us only, I want to list the most important historical facts of the in-betweenness. The region was divided since the beginning of the 14th century and until the eve of World War I between the Ottoman Empire, the Austro-Hungarian Empire, Prussia, and the Russian Empire. And the boundaries of the various empires shifted repeatedly. The territorial extension of the Ottoman Empire in southeastern Europe occurred in the 14th and 15th centuries and lasted until the Russian-Turkish War of 1877-78 and the Balkan Wars of 1911 and 12. The Austro-Hungarian Empire included what was the Kingdom of Hungary and the Austrian Empire and became Austria-Hungary after the Compromise of 1867. The successor states became independent after the Saint-Germain and Sèvres treaties of 1918. The territorial expansion of the Russian Empire in Europe occurred mainly under Peter the Great and Catherine the Great in the 17th and 18th centuries. And the societies and national states became a part of the satellite countries of the Soviet Union after the Second World War. I quote for this historical situation of the region, Grossian, I quote, "History matters. Having belonged to the same former empire for more than 100 years has the consistent and robust effect of diminishing dissimilarities in social trust, even when physical distance between locations, social, democratic, economic, and geopolitical conditions are taken into account." End quote. The instability of the borders is not only a historical characteristic of the region, but in some cases very recent ones too. After the rebuilding and creation of many nation states following the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991, Kosovo declared its independence 10 years ago, 2008. Originally Ukrainian territory since its transfer by Khrushchev in 1954 from the Russian Soviet Federal Socialist Republic, the Crimean Peninsula was annexed by the Russian Federation in 2014. And more brutally, in the same year, Russian hybrid forces occupied parts of Luhansk and Donetsk in the eastern part of Ukraine. For the entire borderline area, this reshaping of the state borders recalls the traditional instability, to not mention the fear in the Balkan area of a possible occupation. So history is a matter, and the history show us this in-between situation of the entire region. And that has many consequences, many important consequences, not only for the political and economical situation in the countries, but as well for the theory building about the region. So now the central term of my thesis or theory, woundedness. Many scholars dealing with the identity questions of the region use the Greek term trauma. But I decided on wound, the English translation of the notion of trauma. I did this for two main reasons. First, trauma is often used today for private and spiritual damage. But a wound, according to my understanding, is not a private matter, and neither is it only a spiritual fact, but one with more of an institutional, political, and economical dimensions. Second, the term wound and its plural wounds opens other associations of trauma, not less concerning the recently often used English term vulnerability, which comes from the Latin equivalent of trauma, vulnus. So I understand wounds in this way. And one more important term, which is crucial for my theory, memory. To concentrate on the geopolitical and geocultural impacts, it is very important to distinguish between history and memory, and then, in turn, between memory and remembering. There are many region-specific historical facts which differentiate the region of Central and Eastern Europe from other cultural regions of Europe. But in dealing with questions of identity, of collective identity, and with the interpretation of the collective identity, we should concentrate on the memory, which means on the presence of the historical facts in the ever-contemporary societal discourse. But regarding memory, there are two ways of remembering that are important to distinguish. First, the first one is the organic memory of private persons, families, local communities, transmitted by storytelling and vernacular customs. The second kind of memory, canonized by the central power of the society through national festivals, canonical heroes, canonized heroes, anthems, school books, etc. The first kind of memory has more local or regional relevance. The second stays in the service of the homogenization of national states. George Mink coined the term memory games for this second type of memory. The concept of memory games encompasses the various ways by which political and social actors perceive and relate to certain historical events according to the identities they construct, the interests they defend, and the strategies they devise to define, maintain, or improve their position in society. That is, according to Mink, memory games. In my framework, designated by the term woundedness, I attempt to set my starting point in the analysis in the regional memory of pain, tragedies, insecurities, and fears transmitted by various societal actors. My main argument is that besides the relevant and essential approach to Central and Eastern Europe from the point of view of the economy, history, social history, political science, and global studies, it is necessary to draw an analytical observation regarding the spiritual, emotional dimension as well. By doing this, there is, on the one hand, always a danger of becoming part of the very neuroticized political discourse and to give up the necessary methodological distance from the emotional waves. It is a big temptation, not so easy to be stable. But on the other hand, neglecting the dimension of woundedness would exclude one of the most important impact factors in the region. As I wrote this paragraph, I read the book of Moesi, The Geopolitics of Emotions. Very interesting book, very inspiring book. So, when the memory of collective wounds is to be considered as the focus of the collective identity of the region, then the most appropriate research question regarding religion can be only, what kind of function does religion play in societies in relation to the wounded identity? That is the central analytical question. Past dependency in this framework means not the differences in the transformation in Central and Eastern Europe in the light of the values of modernity of Western European social development. The basic issue is, accordingly, not how delayed modernity in Central and Eastern Europe is compared to the West, as Bibo asked, and asked many today too, but how social and cultural characteristics mirror the wounded collective identity. It is a quite different approach as the most used approach. Collective identity is the basic self-interpretation of a given group or society. It contains different elements of consciousness, partly stable and partly changing in a dynamic harmony, which makes it possible for individuals to belong to this common orientation and for the group to have a so-called V-consciousness. Wounded collective identity is characterized by a definitive motif of the memory of a special set of indirect experienced collective traumas. It is important to remark that it's not a direct experience by the population today if they memorize historical facts 100 or more hundred years before. But it is very interesting how vivid can be in this collective memory facts from a far history. What I claim is that Central and Eastern Europe is uniquely characterized by a special common set of directly and indirectly experienced traumas, which is the leitmotif for its collective identity. Five main wounds, wound types, can be, according to my research, differentiated in the center of the collective memory of the region, although with different combinations and accents, but they are all present in every society in the region. And exactly this common presence makes the region unique among other regions of Europe and of the world. So the first type of wound is the lack of national state autonomy and sovereignty due to the occupations of three big hegemonies, at least, Sweden, the in-between geopolitical and geocultural position of the entire region prohibited for 100 or to 400 years the building and or rebuilding of sovereign national states. mainly beginning with the historical period of the rise of modern nationalism among every bigger ethnicity, arose an irresistible desire for a sovereign national state, which was fulfilled in some cases only after the political turn 1991 for the Baltic states, 1994 for the Balkan states, and, as I mentioned already, 2008 for Kosovo. That is the first type of wounds. The second one, the forced mobility. Forced mobility of ethnic minorities, ethnic cleansing, you know, deportations a lot. And a second kind of forced mobility too, the status, forced status, or status mobility. It means a forced mobility between social strata and career path according to the loyalty to the new regime, to the ever new regime. The third one is the prohibition of the exercising of human rights, especially of ethnic minority rights. One of the main consequences of the lack of state sovereignty and of the loser overlap of the cultural, ethnic, and nation-state borders in the overall minority status of larger populations in the region. Because of the main logic of ethnicity-based national states, the prohibition of the exercising of ethnic minority rights, first of all, the public and official use of the ethnic language, was a logical but negative consequence of the basic situation. It is not something surprising. The fourth one, persecution of religion, churches, and dissidents, not only faithful people was persecuted. In the period of state-supported religion, mainly the Christian religion, non-Christian and small Christian denominations were not recognized according to the law and or were persecuted. These, not only due to the theological logic of the right religion, vera religione, by Augustine, but also due to the strong connection between the state and the dominant religion and churches. In the long period of communist rule, main religions and the dominant churches, first the Roman Catholic Church, because of the church center in the Vatican, in a capitalistic country, so were considered enemies, they are, and were persecuted, not uncommonly in a brutal and violent way. Every perspective and institution which did not share the ideology and the goals of the communist rulers was seen as an opposing power, dissidents in the same way as people of religious conviction. And the fifth one, it is the most tragical wound of the region, they are the genocides and other kinds of mass killings. For me, it is not so important, the big discussion, what is a genocide, what is only mass killing, sorry. First, early in the 20th century, the communist state caused millions of deaths. Then the national socialist dictatorship, and more recently, the regular and irregular forces in Bosnia and Herzegovina did. Totalitarian states as such are referred by Rummel in many publications of him as mortocracies and mega murders. Geographically, genocides and other mass killings occur with higher likelihood in Central and Eastern Europe than elsewhere in Europe. I cannot mention now the mass killings outside of Europe, in the Third World or in China. After the list of the main categories of the wounds, I would like to make only one remark to highlight the interpretative relevance of this framework. George Mindenberg, in his book from the last year about the radical right movements in Central and Eastern Europe, concluded that the clear difference between the radical right in West and in East can be explained exactly by taking in mind the impact of these wounds that I mentioned. Mindenberg wrote, referring to Brubaker, of course, I quote, "Many post-socialist nations could be characterized by a triadic configuration of nations between nationalizing states, the existence of national minorities within the new states, and the existence of external homelands. It is in this arena where ongoing efforts of nation building tend to override other issues. They, more than other factors, help explain the mobilization of the radical right." And of course, not only this part of the recent transformations of the radical right, but a lot of other. Now I return to the dimension of religion. The region of Central and Eastern Europe is characterized on the one hand by the in-between geopolitical status and on the other, mainly because of this status, by the above-mentioned fifth types of wounds. Following my core argument, the appropriate theoretical framework for the interpretation of the societal transformation of the region is the wounded collective identity. This approach tries to be an alternative to many other valid and important approaches generally used and scrutinized by the scholars of the region. The first reason to aim the work with an alternative approach is to break up the routine and to make possible new observations, insights, and associations possible. In social theory, modernization is the general and basic theoretical framework. For the religious dimension, the theory of secularization is used and analyzing religious transformation. Both approaches, modernization and secularization, were put forward in the 60s in the North Atlantic region based on the social and cultural experiences in the given cultural circumstances. For quite a while, the approach of modernity has had a universal relevance and validity. But first, the postcolonial theory draws attention to the hermeneutical limits of this theory. Homi Bhabha said, Chakrabarti, Talal Asad, and a lot of more. And furthermore, Shmuel Eisenstadt, the famous sociologist from Israel, multiple modernity approach relativized the universal validity of modernization. I understand my framework of the wounded collective identity to be a regional alternative to the theory of modernization, which relativizes its indisputability and opens the door for new insights in the region Central and Eastern Europe. So I will focus now to the roles of religion in the region. And three main terms for understand this role is continuity, autonomy, and stability. Religion as culture and tradition, as well as institution, has played an important role in the 200-year-long history of the entire region. I concentrate only on this short period. There are, of course, differences among the countries in their historical past dependence, but with regard to the wounded collective identity, they are basically similar. Four main characteristics of the role of the churches and religion in this 200-year period. At the time of the formation of modern national states, Roman Catholicism, Protestantism, and Orthodoxy as well, supported the efforts for autonomy. Secondly, the interval period they preserved and represented historical and cultural continuity. The third one, in the 70 or 40 year long period of communist dictatorship, they served as reminders to the times of organic societal development, although church institutions were suspended, or at least obstructed in their work, and practicing religion was persecuted and or forbidden. And fourth one, at the time of the change of regime and thereafter, many religious institutions have supported the stabilization of the new post-communist system and the building or rebuilding of the sovereign nation states. Data, how big impact this story has today as well, we have data taken from the American Research Institute Pew Forum, you know. These data demonstrate the strong correlation between national interests and support given by religion and churches. And to speak in more general terms, I argue with Spohn, a very important author, about this topic. I quote, organized religion, churches, and religious communities were crucial collective actors in these transformation processes. Social protest movements and national identities were often influenced by religion, and in some cases, fundamentalist value orientations also played an important role. End quote. The hermeneutical focus on the wounded collective identity allows for the religious actors, representatives, and theologians to carry out a critical evaluation of their own historical role under the circumstances of the in-between geopolitical and geocultural position. Religions and churches must recognize and confront the woundedness of the region in an analytical and critical evaluation of their own wounded history and their role as victim, perpetrator, and bystander too. Focusing on the wounded identity allows, for instance, an alternative understanding of the role of religion and churches in the case of their support of nationalistic aims, especially in ethnic cleansing and genocides. The strong support of state nationalism from the main churches is an inherent consequence of the geocultural position and tradition of the nation states. When state sovereignty and autonomy is the aim for centuries and above all, the main religions and churches as part of society can hardly make another decision than to support the success of national ambitions. Most of all, the Protestant and the Orthodox churches can and will do that because they are national churches, fully intertwined with the nation. Throne and altar, with this old term, throne and altar are in these cases not in alliance but with each other, but in symphony, to use the term of the Orthodox tradition and the Orthodox theology, Christian Orthodox one. The indisputable support for the state on the institutional level, but also on the level of public thinking, is not only a consequence of the wounds of the instability, but also an argument for their great impact. The approach of wounded collective identity can interpret this position as meaningful as well. On the one hand, religions are a polydimensional part of the history of the region, which had a limitative possibility to make sovereign decisions. It is true, but on the other hand, especially religions also have an alternative resources which they fall back on the on in the processes of the permanent reinterpretation of their own collective identity as an entity in the world, but not from the world. That is the quote of the Evangelium of John. So in the world, but not of the world. In the main marker, if the main marker of the region is the wounded collective identity, then there is, especially for the Christian kerygma, an association with the spirituality and theology of the wounds of Jesus Christ, which symbolize the center of the Christian faith, resurrection and salvation. So wounded identity, wounded Christ. That is a possible parallelity. The five stigmata of Jesus can exist in parallelism with the stigmata of regional identity. And the religious Christian perspective concerning the stigmata can and perhaps should be employed for a kind of public theology, an original contribution to the understanding and managing of the main national and regional tasks. Based on these evaluative insight, a Christian public theology can develop a critical view concerning the recent instrumentalization of religions and churches by the political powers today. It's observable in every state of our region. If it goes, namely, too far, the tension in religion and in the churches will increase, and the religious political discourse can cause a decline of religiosity, in fact, with a secularizing consequence. So I summarize. As the first step, I have attempted to evaluate the geopolitical position of Central and Eastern Europe and come to the main thesis, namely, that the in-between status has the highest impact on the forming of the collective identity in the region, which I call wounded. As the second step, I have listed the region-specific wounds, and finally, I concentrated on the religious dimension of this transition by recognizing the past dependence of religion and the special possibilities inherent in the Christian kerygma too. In this talk, I have aimed to offer my ideas only in terms of a grounded theory, that is, from an evidence-based perspective for further research and discussions, which this university community is possibly the best place in Hungary and as well in the whole region. Thank you for your kind attention.